Either we heal as a team, or we're gonna crumble. Inch by inch, play by play, till we're finished. We're in hell right now, gentlemen, believe me. And we can stay here, get the shit kicked out of us, or we can fight our way back into the light. We can climb out of hell, one inch at a time. You know, when you get old in life, things get taken from you. I mean, that's part of life. But you only learn that when you start losing stuff. You find out life's this game of inches. So is football. Because in either game, life or football, the margin for error is so small. I mean, one half a step too late or too early, and you don't quite make it. One half second too slow, too fast, you don't quite catch it. The inches we need are everywhere around us. They're in every break of the game, every minute, every second. On this team, we fight for that inch. On this team, we tear ourselves and everyone else around us to pieces for that inch. We claw our fingernails for that inch. Because we know when we add up all those inches, that's going to make the fucking difference between winning and losing. It's the guy who's willing to die who's going to win that itch. And I know if I'm going to have any life anymore, it's because I'm still willing to fight and die for that itch. Because that's what living is. The 6 inches in front of your face. Now I can't make you do it. You got to look at the guy next to you. Look into his eyes. Now I think you're going to see with you.
Hell yeah.
You're gonna see a guy who will sacrifice himself for this team because he knows when it comes down to it, you're gonna do the same for him.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah.
That's a team, gentlemen. Team. Hell yeah. And either we heal now as a team,
or we will die as individuals.
Ideas are bulletproof.
That's right. Either we come together and stand together as one unit for freedom, love, and humanity, and justice and fairness, which are more than just words. Like V said in V for Vendetta, freedom, fairness, and justice, they're more than words. They're perspectives. It's a perspective on life to be free. Not allow the government to follow every little thing you do, tell you what you can and can't eat, tell you what you can, what you have to put in your body. You must let us invade your physical being and inject foreign antibodies and viruses and God knows whatever other crap they're injecting into you. Fetal tissue from, you know, cows. It's disgusting. We have to stand up and take back what's ours, our bodies, our freedoms, our civil liberties. Tell the TSA to screw off. You're not touching me. I'm going to tell you what, one of my friend's wives, she flew, that kind of sounds like he's got multiple wives. Let me rephrase that. My friend's wife and their two kids flew to go visit her parents. And this was today. And she was going through the airport and she put TSA on notice right off the bat. And she told them, this was through Miami International Airport, and she told them right off the bat, you will not be touching me. You will not be touching my children. If you touch my children, I will scream bloody murder and I will sue every one of you. And luckily, my friend, he's not rich, but he's well off enough that he could afford to probably sue every one of the TSA agents. And she knows that, so she stood firm and she stood by it and she told him no. And she told him, and she made a scene about it so other people would hopefully, you know, have the cojones to do it as well. And she told them, you're not putting me in that microwave box either. And you're not putting my children in the microwave box. I won't tolerate any of this crap from any of you people. Do you understand? And to my surprise, they backed off and let her go right through security. Didn't even mess with her. So See what standing up for yourself does? No, I'm not saying it's going to work with every TSA agent and every out of control officer, but you still have to stand your ground no matter what. Stay the course. Don't be afraid. And I'm sure most of you played sports when you were a kid at one point or another. That's just like playing baseball. If you're afraid of getting hit by that baseball, you're going to flinch and you're going to strike out. You might actually get hit by the ball. You're never going to hit it. But if you keep your eye on that ball, when that ball comes at you, you park that thing. You land it out into the outfield or beyond. You know, same thing with hockey. People, you know, I'm sure first couple times they play hockey, they're afraid to get hit, knocked down. After a while, you know, look at some of these guys take hits and they get back up and they keep on trucking. Same thing with football. And no, I'm not a big sports fan at all, actually. I'm just using that because most people in this country are sports fans. So most people can, they can understand where I'm coming from on that level. Myself, I don't watch sports. I think organized sports is nothing more than brainwashing. I would rather put my energy forth into things that I do, like the radio show or the website and everything else. And speaking of the website, within the next few days, actually probably within the next 24 hours, we've already released some of the footage, and I finalized the page today about the war crimes in Libya taking place by NATO and by the NATO-backed rebels, otherwise known as Al-Qaeda. So you should go check it out. You can see what we're doing. You can see how unjustified it is and how we're not there to save civilians, considering we just blew up a house, killed over 15 civilians, including babies and young children, you know, like I'd say from the age of like maybe 12 down. And the pictures are gruesome. They're the videos of what the rebels are doing is gruesome. There's cannibalism videos. I'm not kidding. There's and it's videos shot that I was able to get. And I wasn't like I was looking for them. Somebody approached me and asked me. Susan Lindauer approached me and asked if I could help because she had been given these videos by foreign press and by aid agencies and by refugees. You know, the refugees didn't contact her through like a foreign aid agency. You know, somebody that knew Susan got a hold of her and you know how it is. But she asked me if we could help get them out and show people what was going on. And you can see in the videos that are coming out, they're captured Libyan soldiers, Gaddafi's guys, captured by the rebels that NATO is backing, and they are forced to eat a dead Libyan soldier. Cannibalism. Forced cannibalism. And these are the guys that we're backing in NATO. But hey, they're freedom fighters. So everybody raise your glass to the freedom fighters that we're backing in Libya as they force their opponents to eat each other. There's videos where they cut the throats of the Libyan soldiers and they're taking all their weapons and they prop up the bodies and show you what they did to these guys. So, you know, these are the people we're backing. And the beheading video, somebody said, well, this looks like what happened in Iraq. And Susan and I both explained that the reason it looks like that is because the same people that were behind some of the beheadings in Iraq, the CIA controlled Al-Qaeda in Iraq are the same people that were backing these rebels in Libya. They're the exact same people. So where do you think they picked up that little trick from? Where do you think they picked that up from? You think it was just coincidental? No. There is no such thing as coincidence, especially considering we've admitted that we have CIA, the CIA we have guys that are assets of the CIA and CIA agents themselves on the ground controlling things. We already have boots on the ground in Libya. World War III is starting. You know, there's a guy, this little fat, jolly, fat fellow professor. I think it's called Skeptical Humanities or something is his website. And he's a professor up in Georgia. And he likes to attack truth tellers and call us conspiracy theorists and everything else and joke. And he attacked Jones's video about World War III. And he said, oh, in case you didn't know, apparently we're in World War III. You know, joking around about it. It's not a joke. You know, we're bombing Pakistan. Pakistan's about ready to start fighting back physically with us. China is getting pissed off. Russia is getting pissed off about Libya. China's going to dump, you know, they're saying they're going to dump everything that they have dollar-wise, American, you know, of the American dollar-wise. Russia, they're getting pissed at us. They're getting pissed at NATO. NATO itself is falling apart. So you can see this isn't a humanitarian mission. I mean, Germany pulled out of NATO because of this, because of what's going on, because they realize this is an illegal attack. They're trying to provoke World War III. Why is NATO in Northern Africa? NATO wasn't even formed to be going outside the boundaries of Europe. NATO was formed to protect Europe from the Soviet Union, the communist threat of the Cold War era. But when the communist threat went away, NATO never went away. No, we're not going to take it. That's why I come on the radio three times a week and I rant and rave and I get pissed off because I try to light a fire up under your rear end so you get mad and you do something about it. You know, I do as much as I possibly can, but I'm not going to win this myself. You know, all the separate We Are Change chapters aren't going to win it themselves. Alex Jones isn't going to win it himself. RTR is not going to win it themselves. But all of us working together, you know, the Intel Hub, the Bob Tuscan Radio Show, RTR, Federal Jack, We Are Change, everybody working together as one cohesive, strong unit, we're having an effect. Coming out of Bilderberg, it was leaked that they're really pissed about the global awakening that's happening. People are starting to realize that there's more going on. There's things behind the scenes, and they don't like it. If anybody listens to Lindsey Williams, he's come out in the past couple of days and said the same thing, that his intel sources have said that the Bilderberg Group and these elites are pissed at us because they're not pissed. I mean, they're pissed at us, but they're pissed in general because people are waking up, and that's good. And if any of them or any of their little lackey cronies ever get to hear this broadcast, screw you. Screw you, Rockefeller. Screw you, Rothschild. Screw the rest of you. I won't even sit here and name, you know, I have a couple things I'd like to talk about, so I don't want to waste the rest of my day naming them all off. But let's just say screw the whole New World Order and everybody that goes along with it and anybody that's attached to it. You know, whether it be a nation state, you know, the government, if it's the entire government, the entire nation, the people of that nation, or if it's just the government of that nation, or even individuals involved. Whoever's involved with this secret agenda, you can all kiss my rear end and screw. We're going to beat you, and then we're going to start punishing you. And by punishing, I mean public flogging and hanging. We're going to bring back the good old days. So look forward to it. All right, today I want to get into a few things, but the first thing, if I have enough time, I might get this might take up most of the rest of the time, but I want to get into this because it's rather important. I want to just give some examples of facts. I mean, these are not opinions. These are not made up. These are facts that refute the official conspiracy theory of 9/11. And so people understand a conspiracy theory, you know, is a theory that two or more people got together and conspired to do something bad. You know, even the government's own theory is a conspiracy theory. And in fact, the man who wrote a thesis for Obama, or a paper for Obama, or I shouldn't say for Obama. He wrote this about the 9/11 truth movement. Now he works for Obama. His name's Cass Sunstein. He talks about how the 9/11 truth movement is very bad, needs to be taken down and destroyed. And I'm currently reading a book written by David Ray Griffin, great author, and it's called Cognitive Infiltration, an Obama appointee's plan to undermine the 9/11 conspiracy theory. Now, in the book, Sunstein, David Ray Griffin shows how Cass Sunstein, you know, how he even admits in his paper that the government's own version is a conspiracy theory by definition. So, now that we're all on the same page that even the government's theory is a conspiracy theory, we can maybe get rid of the negative connotation associated with that term. I know the establishment media and shills and all these quote-unquote debunkers out there love to say conspiracy theorists, but let's be honest about it. It's a theory that somebody got together, two or more people got together and conspired to do something bad, which is what the government says. And again, you have an Obama administration appointee admitting in a paper that, yes, the government's own theory is a conspiracy theory. Otherwise, the only other theory would be coincidence theory, and it wouldn't be a coincidence that a bunch of guys came together to hijack a plane. That's a conspiracy. So, now that we're past that, I want to give you guys some information and some facts that refute the official, and when I say official, I mean the government's conspiracy theory, and show they actually back up the alternative conspiracy theory that it was allowed to happen and perpetrated by a rogue element. And it was assisted by multiple intel organizations from around the world, which obviously would be a global endeavor, and hence globalism, the New World Order. I mean, it's not that hard to put it together. I understand for the skeptics. I know a lot of them, like the fat, jolly little elf that runs the that skeptical humanities thing, I think it is. He's tried to take on Bob a few times. He takes on everybody. He writes about me. Apparently, I'm Bob's chum. That's what he calls me. I'm Popeye from Federal Jack, Bob's chum. And apparently, the fat, jolly little elf likes to rag on people that, you know, talk truth. And he conspiracy theorist. He's whack nut conspiracy theorist. Yet, he doesn't even look up the definition of the term. So hopefully, Fatty, you're listening and you'll learn some stuff tonight. Get your pen and notepad and sit back and take some notes. Okay, here's some facts that refute the official story. Now, we're going to break in a few minutes, so I'll just give you a couple small ones, and then we'll get into the deeper, longer ones when we come back. Ted Olson's claim that he was called twice by his wife, Barbara Olson, from American Flight 77 is not at all supported by the FBI report on phone calls from this plane. So the FBI's official report that's in the 9/11 commission report does not jive with Ted Olson coming on and saying that Barbara called him from the flight. Even though that this has been pushed out, the mainstream media will tell you, well, remember Ted Olson? You know, every year on 9/11, they always bring up Ted Olson and Barbara Olson and everything that happened. They're official, because remember, they have to reiterate the official lie, okay? They have to keep pushing that home. And if you look, the official reports don't match up. The FBI report does not match up with what Olson said. You know, they went and checked things out, and it would have been impossible because cell phone calls couldn't have been made from the altitude back then. Wasn't available. That technology has only come out within the past couple of years, but I'd say past like 4 or 5 years. And there were no air phones on those planes. They've already, I think it was a Boeing, and they came out, the aircraft manufacturer came out and said, there is no, we don't have air phones on that plane. I think it was a 757. You know, they didn't have air phones on those planes. Maybe they do now, but back then they didn't. And most people could just use their cell phones on planes now, you know. Whereas back 10 years ago, we didn't have that capability. You didn't have that ability at all. And it's been tested. People went up in airplanes. You know, scientists have done this, and they've gone up in airplanes and taken, you know, different heights, different altitudes, and they've gone up and tried to make cell phone calls, and they didn't even have to go up as high as they said. They went up in a small plane, and they went up as high as like 7,000 and 8,000 feet, and they couldn't make the calls that they said were being made at 20,000 and 30,000 and 40,000 feet. And then United came out a couple of years after 9/11 with this big hoo-ha about how the phone calls, or not about the phone calls on 9/11 per se, but how you can make phone calls from their planes now. And it was all this new technology. Now you can make calls at 30,000 and 40,000 feet. But on 9/11, I thought you could do that years before. So why is it a new technology? You see how they get caught lying? We're going to break, guys. We'll be right back. This is Down the Rabbit Hole. You're listening to me on the Orion Talk Radio Network, Micro 1650 AM. What you did that day, kill your own citizens to advance your ways. All my real patriots stand up and say 9/11 was an inside job. They lie, they scam, they cheat and steal. They plot, they fund, they act, it's real. They watch, they hunt, they punish and kill. Welcome back. It is Wednesday, June 22nd, 2011. I'm your host, Popeye, and this is Down the Rabbit Hole. I'm fired up today. I'm in a foul mood. I've been working on the page I was talking about in the first segment. And before I forget, because I'm going to get back into 9/11, I just want to tell you guys, go to the front of Federal Jack. Within the next day or so, on the right-hand side, I'll have a widget with a picture. You can just click on it. It'll bring you to the page. But for right now, if you go to Federal Jack under the header, when you get to federaljack.com, you'll see one of the things up in the top header there. It's a special. On PCs, you can highlight it. Or on a Mac, you click on it, and it'll bring the drop-down menu. It'll pop down. About halfway down in the middle, you'll see one that says Nate. There's a couple events there, but one of them says, because there are a couple different pages that we've put up and put together over the years. But one of them says NATO and Al-Qaeda war crimes in Libya, and that's the page I just made. Just click on that for right now, and it'll have links to articles. I'm putting up more because Susan Lindauer is working on another article, very in-depth. So... in fact, after the show, I gotta hit her up and contact her about the article and everything. But it'll be updated with newer videos and everything through over the course of the next couple of days. And I want you guys to push this, not because of gore factor or anything else, but because we have to get the truth out. We need to get the people of this country to see what's going on, so they put a halt to this war. The reason why you see all this. This playing around and this song and dance, this kabuki theater of bringing people out of Afghanistan is because the general public is starting to get pissed off, just like they did with Vietnam. And that's what helped shut Nam down. And that's what we need to get, is the sleeping giant pissed about all these foreign wars. So hopefully we'll, the general populace will see what we're doing. So you can check that out. And again, I'll be letting you guys know about it in the future, and I'll be having Susan back on. She's going to be coming back on once or twice a month as a correspondent to let me, to let the listeners and everybody know what's going on and keep everybody apprised. So, all right, getting back into 9/11, I was talking about the telephone calls in the last segment. Well, the FBI report on phone calls from United Flight 93 now says that Tom Burnett used a seat back phone to call his wife, Dina Burnett, although she had reported. And still to this day reports that his cell phone number came up on her phone's caller ID. And they've never been able to explain that away, because the original story was, of course, because he called from his cell phone. And then once the evidence came out that it wasn't possible back then, for the technology didn't exist for cell phone calls to be made from 30,000 or 40,000 feet, they had no choice but to change the report to it was an air phone. But how would an air phone pop up her husband's cell phone number, especially 10 years ago, because cell phones weren't as popular as they are today? In fact, it was the event of 9/11 that actually made cell phones more popular, because of the whole cell phone call myth, and that people were able to say to their loved ones, I love you, I'm going to die, and say their last goodbyes. And everybody and their mother started getting cell phones, and then they started making family share plans and all this other crap. It's kind of amazing how one thing goes hand in hand with another. Now, again, they've never explained it, and Dina Burnett has never changed her story, but of course the FBI and the federal government have. So when you have somebody changing their story over and over again, usually you call them a liar. In a court of law, if this actually went to a real court of law, this would, you know, any real judge worth his weight in gold would freak about it. So, of course, most judges wouldn't. This wouldn't get as far as that because the federal government will never let it get that way. Unless we, the people, stand up and say, enough is enough. We want a real investigation. The federal government doesn't say, you know, just because they say, well, we're not going to. We already did an investigation in 9/11. Now, you did a whitewash investigation, and everybody and anybody knows it. Fire Engineering Magazine called it a half-baked farce. And that's a well-respected magazine in the firefighting community. It's been around for over 100 years. Fire Engineering Magazine. Okay, and just so people understand, Popular Mechanics, a couple months before they did their hit piece on 9/11 Truth, they fired all the editors that were there for like 25 and 30 years, and these guys all had PhDs in engineering and everything else. And in they brought this little geeky schmuck that you see with the ruffled hair, the guy that goes on Glenn Beck. I forget his name, and he's got glasses. You know, he refutes the FEMA camps and 9/11 Truth and everything else. Yeah, you know what his job used to be before he was at Popular Mechanics? He was the editor over at Entertainment Weekly magazine. So before they do an investigation into the quote-unquote biggest terror attack ever in this nation's history, they fire the guys that have 25, 30 years experience as engineers, you know, degrees. They've been there at the magazine. They know everything. These were the head editor and, you know, his whole editorial staff. Fired them all. Fired every single one of them and replaced them all with new people. People like this guy. Tell me what the hell kind of qualifications this turd has to be telling engineers and architects that they're crazy, or telling scientists that they're crazy, or telling firefighters that were there that they're crazy, or telling you, me, or anybody else for that matter that we're crazy because we understand basic science and physics. It's a game. It's misdirection. They don't want you looking at the obvious facts. You know, NIST, even in their report on Building 7, they literally, you can go look it up, it says, then a miracle occurred. That's the official government theory, is that a miracle occurred and that it has a low probability of occurrence. So they're telling you it has a snowball's chance in hell that this actually occurred. But they're invading countries based on these government reports. So keep that in your hat. Just remember that. How about the fact that Hani Hanyor, this guy couldn't fly a single engine plane. Okay? Could not fly it. But yeah, he steered a 757, Flight 77, supposedly, into the Pentagon. Now, the authors of the Popular Mechanics report explain this little anomaly away by saying, oh, well, he had it on autopilot most of the time. And then took the controls at, you know, the final little loop-de-loop into the Pentagon. Well, that was the hardest maneuver of the whole thing. Everything else was just straight-line flying, which he could have done, you know, if he had known how to fly. Obviously, if he had the skills to pull off this loop-de-loop, then he should have had the skills to fly it in a single straight line. I mean, that doesn't make sense. That's like saying you have the skills to run, but you can't walk. Right? You have to learn to walk before you can run. And yet the 9/11 Commission wants you to believe that this guy, who in the terms of running or walking, couldn't walk, but he's running like Jackie Joyner Kersee. Okay. I don't believe it. The trainers that trained Hani Hanyor said there was no way, none at all, that guy, he could have flown Flight 77 into the Pentagon the way they say it hit. The air traffic controllers didn't even think it was a passenger jet because of the way it flew. Pilots for 9/11 Truth have shown it's impossible for a plane to have flown that low at the speed that they say it would have. The plane would have literally been torn apart because of the density of the air. The air is denser down here. It's less dense when you get up higher. It's denser down here. So the density of the air was thicker. The plane wouldn't be able to do it. Pilots for 9/11 Truth, and these are all professional pilots, 30, 40-year experienced pilots, They'll tell you there's no way the plane could have done that. They say it flew straight, like, you know, what 8 or 11 feet off the ground and straight into the Pentagon. You can't do that with a commercial airliner that size. That's comical. Come on, people. Use your common sense. Think about things for a minute. Don't just buy into what people feed you. Don't listen to the boob tube. Turn that crap off. Sit down and listen. I know sometimes 9/11 truthers are a little, you know, much to handle sometimes. I understand that. Sometimes they, you know, I used to be like that when I first got into this years ago. And a lot of the younger guys are like that. They're very energetic and they want you to understand what's going on. You know what? That's good. But I understand sometimes they give you too much. Not a problem. Baby step, one thing at a time. But check it out. Check out the fact that you can't just discard. These facts do not back up the government official conspiracy theory of 9/11. They actually refute it, crap all over it. We'll be right back. Don't break. Stay tuned. This is Down the Rabbit Hole. I'm your host, Popeye, from FederalJack.com. Check out my website during the break. Now I realize that Uncle Sam was not befriending me. He was only using me to be friends with the enemy. A presidential terrorist. Ain't that a contradiction? I guess it goes power. The actions speak loud and pretend to be free. Till you die a slave, a soldier in the desert, searching for a ghost in the cave for the corporation. I run out of patience, sick of seeing troops sent to die for your lives. Spending dollars in debt, we holler in protest. Till we have your arrest, we will not rest. And we know, we know. What you did that day, killed your own citizens to advance your ways. All my real patriots stand up and say 9/11 was an inside job. Welcome back, guys. I'm going to get right back into it because I've only got a few more minutes in this final segment for this evening. And this is an important piece that destroys the hijacker myth on 9/11. Supposedly, the FBI reportedly found a red headband at the Pennsylvania crash site. Now, they reported that they found a red headband there. And this was significant because some of the reported phone calls from the planes described the hijackers as wearing red headbands. According to Jeremy Glick's wife, for example, who Jeremy Glick was a passenger on Flight 93, he reported that the Boeing 757 cockpit had been taken over by three Middle Eastern-looking men wearing red headbands. But former CIA agent Milt Bearden, who had helped train the Mujahideen fighters in Afghanistan, who became Al-Qaeda, pointed out that whereas Al-Qaeda is a Sunni organization, the red headband is uniquely a Shia adornment. Many of us remember that shortly after the invasion of Iraq, some leading figures of the Bush administration were unaware of the difference between Shia and Sunni Muslims. So it kind of makes you wonder who in the Bush administration wrote the script about the red headbands, because the Sunni hijackers of Al-Qaeda would not have been wearing a Shia adornment on their heads, considering they're at war with each other. That would be like a black guy going around in a Ku Klux Klan robe. You wouldn't see it. So, and yes, it's that drastic of a difference for the brain-dead Americans that don't know anything and that might hear this broadcast. Yes, it's that drastic. So I just can't picture that any of this would happen. And I could go on and on. Let's look at the World Trade Center. Let's not look at the hijackers for a second. Let's look at the World Trade Center. Horizontal ejections. Pieces of steel that weighed tens of thousands of tons, 30, 40,000 ton pieces of steel, ejected and thrown hundreds of feet, like as if someone picked it up like a stick and hurled it, embedded, sticking out of the side of high-rise buildings, 700-800 feet away. Gravity cannot do that. And all these scientists, guys like Stephen Jones, and the rest of I can't even remember the other, you know, umpteen, you know, a couple hundred scientists that have all, you know, come out and said it, plus, you know, everybody around the world. You know, I'm sure there's other scientists that have seen it and just not come out and said it. But anyway, these guys all say the same thing. They've proven and shown physics, using physics. You cannot have that. There is no power. There's no energy to account for gravitational, you know, a gravitational force bringing down the towers. Where, what's, how does gravitational force shoot things horizontally? It doesn't. It's impossible. Explosive force would do that. In fact, explosive force is the only thing that explains horizontal ejections. Go watch a big Hollywood blockbuster movie. When they blow up a house, don't look at the roof. Look at the side walls of the building. Go after this broadcast, go look up on Netflix or whatever, on your hard drive, whatever you have. Look up whatever movies you have. Go look at one where there's lots of explosions and they blow a building up, like a house, or, you know, some, you know, they're attacking a camp and they blow up one of the military bases in like Guatemala or whatever. They're, you know, go look at it. When they blow up a building using, and in the movies they use usually simple dynamite. They don't use C4 most of the time. They just use simple dynamite, but or and gasoline because it makes big explosions and stuff. But when I say explosion, I mean fireball. Go look at the side of the building. It'll blow it. You'll see the 2x4s and the sides of the building explode, and you'll always see they have that side camera shot. You see the 2x4s coming at you, all horizontal ejections. Gravity pulls down. How could those huge metal beams be tossed around? Just like you see those 2x4s getting blown out of, you know, a building in a movie, and you see the stuff flying to the side. It's exactly what happened on 9/11. An airplane can't do that. Even the explosion from the initial impact would not have been powerful enough to break loose the metal and steel and then hurl it. It's impossible. We're dealing with a physical impossibility. But then when you look at the alternative theory, those physical impossibilities are accounted for, whereas the government's official story, they are not. They are just simply not talked about or ignored. Look at Norman Mineta's testimony. He testified that they were in the bunker at like 9:15 with Dick Cheney. According to the 9/11 Commission report, he didn't get in there till after 10 o'clock, and that was after Flight 93 had crashed. And Norman Mineta testified that that's not, you know, that his testimony refutes that. And when he testified to the 9/11 Commission, you can see it. He said that Dick Cheney was in there at like 9:15, and he pretty much ordered a stand down. Now, he thought it was an order to shoot the plane down, meaning Flight 93, but the standard operating procedure was to shoot the plane down. The only way the orders would still stand, and the only way the person would have to ask that, is if Cheney had given them orders to the contrary of what normal SOP, standard operating procedure, would be. Otherwise, they don't need the president or the vice president or the secretary of defense to tell them what to do. This is, after all, the military. They train for things just like this. That's why the military has a chain of command. Interesting to note, Rumsfeld, up until about a couple of months before 9/11, and I don't remember the exact numbers, but you can go look this up, you never had to get authority from the Secretary of Defense to shoot down an airliner in a hijacking situation. And out of nowhere, Rumsfeld just changes this rule. And then the day after 9/11, they decided that that was a bad idea. And how they fixed the problem was they went back to the exact way things were before Rumsfeld had changed the rule. And that's the exact way it is today. So the laws and rules that we have about escorting hijacked aircraft that are in place today are the same laws that were in place before 9/11 until Donald Rumsfeld changed it a couple of months before 9/11. And then after 9/11 said, oops, that was a bad idea because I wasn't in my office. See, Rumsfeld conveniently wasn't around to get called. He wasn't around. You know where he was? He was outside on the Pentagon. He was helping carrying victims. He was being the hero of the day. And people could say, well, that's awesome, Popeye. How could you say something bad about that? Because he's the Secretary of Defense. That's not his job. It's not his job. His job was to be inside the bunker commanding the United States because we were organizing a defense because he's part of the cabinet. It's not his job to be running around picking people up. In the military, you'd get scolded for crap like that. Even as a firefighter, you'd get scolded for crap like that. There's hundreds of other people out there. Why was Rumsfeld the one person that should have been in there saying, hey, you know, yeah, shoot the plane down, because according to the law, the way they had changed it, and he's out on the field. Interesting, before we go, Go read Fletcher Prouty's book, JFK. He wrote two books, The Secret Team and JFK. When you read JFK, you'll see that the common myth that JFK stopped the Bay of Pigs invasion. He called off the air raid. That's a myth. He didn't call it off. The way it was set up was they needed a final go-ahead approval, and they needed it from Alan Dulles. And you know what? Just like on 9/11, when they needed approval from Rumsfeld to shoot down a plane, and he wasn't around to shoot it down, he wasn't around to give out the command to do it, okay? Just like on that day, same thing happened. He wasn't around. And because Alan Dulles wasn't around, they didn't launch the planes because they needed his final go-ahead. And Dulles just happened to not be in the office to answer the phone at the time that the raid was supposed to go on. Oh, he just happened not to be there. And this is one of the same guys Kennedy fired afterwards. Go figure. It's not a surprise that this stuff happens over and over and over again. Obviously, for things to happen, you would have to have people look the other way. Same thing with JFK's assassination. If he had had the proper protection, and Prouty talked about this a lot, if he had had the proper protection, he never would have gotten shot. And you can see right before the car makes a final turn onto Elm Street, nightmare on Elm Street. Remember, predictive programming, movies, they all try to tell you stuff. Anyway, before he made the turn onto Elm Street, as JFK turned onto Elm Street, the Secret Service was pulled off the back of his car. He had guys that should have been riding on the back. They would have made a shot from the back impossible. They would have been human shields. He should have had motorcycle riders all over the side of him to act as human shields. That's what those guys are. When the president's driving around, they have all the security around him. They're human shields. That's what they're for. They might look pretty on in their uniforms and on their motorcycles, but that's what their job is. And none of that happened. And who secured the president? The Secret Service. Remember, all you need is one person at the top. That's bad. And everything goes to crap. This has been a great show. I will see you guys Friday. Same bat time.
This is Sparta!
Same bat channel. This has been Down the Rabbit Hole. I'm your host, Popeye, from FederalJack.com. And you're listening to me on the Orion Talk Radio Network.